Chapter 2, Cells, the Living Units, Part 2. So, we've completed the talking about the plasma membrane. Now we're moving on to the cytoplasm. Cytoplasma has all the various little structures you see, all these organelles. Each organelle has its own, has its own specific function. And you can sort of think of it as little bitty organs inside the cell. And then, of course, surrounding all the organelles is the fluid. That is referred to as cytosol. So the cytosol is mostly water. It also has lots of ions, nutrients, proteins, and it's not really super liquidy. It's more like a gel than a liquid. Ribosomes. Ribosomes are tiny little protein RNA organelles. The ribosomes are extremely important because they are the structures that produce proteins. So their function is protein synthesis. And the proteins that they produced are determined by commands, directions that come from the nucleus. Ribosomes, again, made of proteins and RNA, they can be found floating free in the cytosol, or they can be bound to the rough endoplasmic reticulum. Which brings us to the endoplasmic reticulum. There are two kinds, smooth ER and rough ER. The endoplasmic reticulum is a system of interconnected membrane envelopes and tubes. So envelopes and tubes. And of course, they are made out of phospholipid bilayer. So very similar structure to the plasma membrane. And it's the endoplasmic reticulum is all throughout the cytoplasm. The rough endoplasmic reticulum is called rough because it is bound to ribosomes. And those make it look bumpy under a light microscope. The functions of the rough endoplasmic reticulum includes the production of proteins to be secreted by the cell, production of proteins that are going to be in the plasma membrane, so those receptors, transmembrane proteins, etc., and also production of digestive proteins. These are enzymes that can break things down and would be good to have carefully isolated within the cell, because you don't want to break the cell down. So rough endoplasmic reticulum, bound to ribosomes, involved in the production of various proteins. The smooth endoplasmic reticulum is smooth because it does not have any ribosomes bound to it. So its functions include lipid metabolism. So it can be involved in making lipids or breaking them down. And also the smooth ER can be involved in the detoxification of some drugs and toxins that the cells might be exposed to. Then we have the Golgi apparatus. Golgi apparatus is a stack of membrane discs, so sort of like a stack of pancakes. The membranes are also made of phospholipid bilayers, so similar structurally to the plasma membrane. Proteins made in the rough endoplasmic reticulum arrive to the Golgi apparatus via vesicles. And within the Golgi apparatus, those proteins will be sorted and modified and shipped out. So it acts sort of like a postal office. So proteins can be sent out via exocytosis to be secreted outside of the cell. And they could be sent to the plasma membrane so that when the vesicles fuse, the plasma membrane proteins in the vesicle are now in the plasma membrane and also can form lysosomes, which will hold the digestive enzymes. So again, here we have the rough endoplasmic reticulum. Proteins produced by it are sent out via vesicles to the Golgi apparatus. There they are sorted, modified, and sent out either by vesicles to be secreted outside of the cell by exocytosis, or sent to the cell's plasma membrane, so the proteins are embedded in the vesicles, lipid bilayer, and then when the vesicle fuses with the plasma membrane, becomes a part of the plasma membrane. And finally, to form specialized structures called lysosomes that are filled with digestive enzymes that need to be isolated so they don't damage the cell. This will bring us to lysosomes. Lysosomes are produced by the Golgi apparatus. Lysosomes are modified vesicles that hold digestive enzymes. These can be used to break down materials that have been brought in by phagocytosis. So, for instance, food particles can then be broken down by the enzymes the digestive proteins in the lysosome. Lysosomes can also fuse with worn-out organelles to break them down and recycle those worn-out organelles. And sometimes the lysosomes are involved in apoptosis. Apoptosis is the programmed cell death. Sometimes the cells we have need to die for developmental reasons. So for instance, when we were embryos, we had little webbings between our fingers. As we developed into fetuses, that webbing was broken down. Those cells were destroyed via apoptosis. Turns out there's a disorder, a genetic disorder called Tay-Sachs disease related to lysosomes. And what occurs is that one enzyme that is stored in lysosomes is defective, does not work properly. And because of that, we get an accumulation of fatty material in the nerve cells of these children. The symptoms start when the infant is 6 months old and continues for the next few years, leading to paralysis, blindness, deafness, getting worse and worse until eventually the child dies, usually around the age 4. So Tay-Sachs disease, a genetic disorder associated with lysosomes, where one enzyme, one digestive enzyme, is defective. Mitochondria. Mitochondria are very important organelles. Mitochondria, as you see here and here, have double membrane structures. So they have two phospholipid bilayers, and they are very important in the production of energy for the cell. It is the mitochondria that produce the ATP, produces the energy our cells use. So ATP, 3-phosphates, the bond between the second and third phosphate is where that high energy is stored to be used by the cell. So mitochondria, energy production structures. Peroxisomes are modified vesicles. They have specialized enzymes functioning in the neutralizing of toxic metabolic wastes. So we have waste products produced by metabolic processes in the cells that are toxic to the cells. They get sent to the peroxisomes where they are neutralized so that they don't damage the cell. So for example, hydrogen peroxide is produced by our cells and it is made into less toxic compounds inside of peroxisomes. Cytoskeleton. Cytoskeleton is kind of sort of an organelle. It is long protein structures stretching throughout the cells. It is like girders, long structures, all connecting the organelles, connecting to the plasma membrane all throughout the cytoplasm. Functions of the cytoskeleton is that it gives the cell its shape, like somewhat like our skeleton gives us our shape. The cytoskeleton can be involved in cell movement, can lead to changing in the cell's shape so that it can move. Internally, the cytoskeleton can act as a highway so that structures inside the cell can move along the cytoskeleton. The vesicles, for instance, move along the cytoskeleton. And then finally, during cell division, the cytoskeleton can help move chromosomes during the cell division process. Centrosomes. Centrosomes are a specialized organelle that produces part of the cytoskeleton, specifically produces the mitotic spindle. Mitotic spindle is very important during cell division. It is the structure that moves the chromosomes during cell division. So centrosomes have two centrioles, and the centrosomes involved in producing mitotic spindle to move chromosomes during cell division. Moving on to the nucleus. The nucleus is the largest organelle in the cell. It also has a double membrane structure, so it's two phospholipid bilayers. And there are large holes in the nucleus's envelope called nuclear pores. And these large holes allow large things to pass into and out of the nucleus. The function of the nucleus is the control center of the cell. The DNA is able to determine what proteins are produced by the ribosomes, and by controlling what proteins are produced, controls the activities occurring in the cell. Each protein is found in a gene, And so that's why we refer to all the DNA as the genetic code. It has many, many genes for each of the proteins, something like 20 to 30,000 genes. And these genes make up the library of you. Also found in the nucleus is another organelle called the nucleolus. Nucleolus is sort of a dark body inside the nucleus, and its job is to make the components of the ribosomes. The parts of the ribosomes are made by the nucleolus in the nucleus, and those parts leave the nucleus to become ribosomes. DNA is a double helix structure, and the DNA gets condensed down into a dense structure called a chromosome. So a chromosome is a very dense, condensed DNA structure. The only time we see the chromosomes are during cell division. The average human, it turns out, has 46 chromosomes. That is 23 pairs of chromosomes. Cell cycle is the life cycle of the cell. Most of the time, the cell is in what is called interphase. This is when the cell does all the various functions the cell needs to do. But then occasionally, some cells will enter the mitotic phase. Mitotic phase is when the cell division occurs, and there are lots of subphases within the mitotic phase. So again, interphase, most of the cell's life allows the cell to grow and function. And then for cells that are going to divide, the cell actually gets even larger than normal and makes a second copy of the DNA, duplicates the DNA. After interphase, some cells that are going to divide go into the mitotic phase, where they undergo mitosis, division of the nucleus, separating of the DNA, the chromosomes, and also the process of cytokinesis, which is the division of the cytoplasm, where the cell becomes two new cells. And then it'll enter interphase again, and you'll now have two identical cells. One cell undergoes interphase, goes through the mitotic phase, enters interphase again as two new identical cells. So interphase, we interphase right before the cell is going to divide. The cell is extra large. The cell has two centrosomes. Of course, we have a nucleus with a nucleolus and relaxed DNA. So the chromosomes are all nice and relaxed. But the DNA in the nucleus is duplicated, so there's two copies of DNA. Then the first part of mitosis is prophase. Prophase is when the DNA condenses down into the chromosomes. The nuclear envelope of the nucleus will break down so that the nucleus breaks down, and the centrosomes go to opposite sides of the cell and start to produce the mitotic spindle. In metaphase, the chromosomes all line up at the midline of the cell. The mitotic spindle attaches to the chromosomes that have all lined up in the middle. And then in anaphase, the mitotic spindles attached to the chromosomes will shorten, pulling the chromosomes apart into two copies of the DNA, one being pulled toward one side of the cell, the other being pulled to the opposite side. So the mitotic spindle pulls the chromosomes apart, and the DNA goes to opposite sides, so that each side of the cell now has a complete copy of the DNA. In telophase, the cytokinesis occurs. The cell starts to break into two new cells, and then we have the nucleus reforming, the chromosomes relaxing back into the relaxed state, and basically the cell returning to the interphase state. Again, cytokinesis is the actual division of the cell into two separate cells, dividing the cytoplasm. Turns out cytokinesis and mitosis occur together at the same time. They're not distinct time-wise. Finally, we have cancer. Cancer is caused when cells in a person's body accumulate many, many mutations in the DNA. And these mutations cause the cell to no longer be able to control cell division, so that these cells now mutate and divide uncontrollably, causing huge masses in inconvenient places in the body. And those mutations, those masses that grow, can also lead to destruction of tissue surrounding those masses. So cancer is very bad. That is it for this lecture.